Okay, now today we're going to finish up with this cycle of the workshop, and we're concluding the workshop with a study of the 12 traditions. Most people, when they hear the meeting is about the traditions, will go find the nearest discussion meeting where everybody can bitch, moan, and complain about their particular personal problems, because Problems Anonymous seems to be the way to go these days. However, I'd like for you to understand, and I hope you do understand, that the principles which we talk about in AA include the 12 traditions. The 12 traditions are extraordinarily important. It is only by virtue of us having those traditions that you and I are here today. Otherwise, this fellowship would have fallen apart long, long, long ago. It would have gone the way of all other attempts to put together some kind of a group that would help the alcoholic and the addict recover. Without those traditions, there's no way in the world we could have survived. And the interesting thing about the traditions, one of the interesting things, is that they apply equally to us as individuals, as well as to our groups and to the fellowship. Remember that the traditions did not come about until in the late 1940s. And as a result of some discussions among the founders, it was decided that we needed to formalize our traditions, to put in writing those things which we intended to follow and which would be the things which would preserve and help grow the fellowship. So Bill was set about the task of writing the traditions in 1946. The so-called long form of the traditions was published in the Grapevine. And after that, there was 4 years when Bill was publishing articles every time they would print one. And he was talking to everybody everywhere about them. He got to a point where they would invite him to come and speak, and the speaker seeker would say, "Bill, we'd love to have you, but don't you even dare mention those damn traditions. We're sick to death of hearing about them." So finally, this whole matter of the traditions was brought to the First International in 1950, and it's interesting. There's a tape recording of Bill's speech to the convention and how he got the traditions accepted by the First International. It wasn't one of those things where they were formally introduced and read and debated. And Bill just simply got up there and he asked a few questions. Is there anybody here, he said, who is against having a set of traditions for this fellowship? If you are, then stand up. Well, nobody stood up. And he went on in that vein, and finally he said, "Well, is there anyone here who's against adopting these traditions as they are presented now in this short form? If you're against it, stand up." Nobody stood up. So he said, "Okay, good, they're adopted." And that was the way it happened. And it's interesting to read or to listen to Bill go through that. It's all on tape. And he was very proud of the fact that his traditions that he had written were adopted by the International in 1950. Of course, since then, in 1953, they were formalized in what we know as the 12 and 12. But prior to that time, Bill had been writing about them extensively. And if you want to know about the traditions, you can forget about 12 and 12. That's a very condensed, puny version of Bill's writings about the traditions. If you have the language of the heart, this book, most of the first full section of this book is concerns itself with the traditions, and there's some absolutely marvelous articles in there which explain in detail what these traditions mean, where they came from, and so forth. Also, last week we made sure to understand that the traditions really started as early as the writing of the Big Book. Because in the forward to the first edition, we find several of the traditions are already spelled out. Even before the big book was ever printed, when they drew up the foreword to the first edition of the big book, the traditions of, as far as membership, and we're going to be looking at tradition three in a minute, that the only requirement for membership was an honest desire to stop drinking. And every time I read that, I get a chuckle because I can't imagine what a dishonest desire would be. But at any rate, that was a little bit of overkill. They took that out, of course, in the tradition itself. And that there are no dues or fees. That's been established with the fellowship for a long, long time. It was something which they really, really started out with. They had learned from the mistakes of the Washingtonians back in the 1800s. And those guys had something good going, but they broke basically all of the traditions, as we now know them, in trying to run that Washingtonian fellowship. And it only lasted 6 years. At the end of 6 years, it simply fell apart because it was an ego trip for the founders. They were rolling in dough. They were announcing themselves by their last names and taking credit all over the place. And they were basking in the glow of all of the publicity and the hero worship. And they tied themselves in with the churches. They tied themselves in with the prohibition movement. They tied themselves in with the abolitionists, the abolition of slavery, political parties, and lent the name and the prestige of the Washingtonians to these political parties. And all of these things contributed to the demise of the Washingtonians. And our guys were familiar with the history of that society, and they saw what the mistakes were, and so they made sure that they didn't make the same mistakes. Last week we talked about the first and second traditions and how tradition 1 and tradition 12 really bookend the other 10 traditions, because they stand for a basic principle. That principle being one of self-sacrifice and humility and the concentration of our efforts and our thinking on the unity of AA and preserving that unity rather than trumpeting our own horns and wanting all of the acclaim and the fame and the notoriety. And that whole concept is embodied as we go through all the traditions. This business of the unity of the fellowship must come first, and that our personal sobriety depends upon the continued existence of AA and the unity of the fellowship. And that sounds a little bit extreme when we first hear it, and yet if we stop to think about it, where else in the world do we find recovery? It is true, and some people point this out, that the big book was written so that technically, and it has from a practical standpoint been used, the big book can be used as basically the sole means of recovery. It's very difficult because this whole program is founded upon the idea of one alcoholic working with another. And as a matter of fact, the more we read the big book, the more convinced we are that some kind of mob action to get somebody sober is useless. Not only useless, it's counterproductive. And that goes not only for a bunch of people ganging up on some poor newcomer and jumping all over them, but it goes equally for the idea that somehow has gotten to be the big thing around here, that it is the group that keeps people sober. That's balderdash. That has almost nothing to do with sobriety. And I guess it comes out of the idea of encounter groups and having facilitators and being entitled to your feelings and you're only as sick as your secrets and on and on and on. All this stuff about if I don't open my mouth, I'll open a bottle and on and on. So dump it all out on the group, walk away feeling good, and let everybody else feel crappy. Especially. And that doesn't work, never has worked. If we remember the roots of our fellowship, we remember that it was Ebby working with Bill one-on-one, which got everything started. And then Bill and Bob working with Bill Dodson, which gave us A number three. It was Roland Hazard working with Abby that put Abby in a place where he could help Bill. The big book says this, and it's the only place in the big book that goes directly to the question of sponsorship, that both you and the new man must walk day by day in the path of spiritual progress. And when we read chapter 7, we realize that it's talking about one-on-one there. One-on-one. That's what we're doing here. That's what sponsorship is. Two people walking day by day in the path of spiritual progress. But where do we find these people? Where do we find the opportunity to exercise our newfound ability to be helpful to God and to the people about us? Of course, we find that in our meetings. We find that in the fellowship. Very seldom are you going to be walking down the street and find some poor drunk sitting there who's going to say, yeah, I really need help. Gee, can you possibly help me? Bill found that out when he tried to do it. He found out that going up to some poor groveling drunk sitting on a bar stool, soaking up the suds, and saying to a man, you're an alcoholic, get on your knees and start praying, that didn't work. Found out that the big book tells us the truth about it. If he is to find God, the desire must come from within. And one of the things that the fellowship does is it creates a milieu, an environment within which a new person can begin to feel comfortable with the idea not only of sobriety, but of the kind of effort that goes into permanent sobriety. And as we read in chapter 5, wanting what we have and being willing to go to any length to get it. And so you see, if we look at it from that standpoint, then the unity of the fellowship is tremendously important, in that we all hang together or we all hang separately. But ultimately, it comes down to one alcoholic, one addict working with another. Because without that, we don't have that transfer of power. Now what happens is this: when you remember your third step prayer and you ask God in that prayer to take away your difficulties so that victory over them might bear witness to those you would help of His power, His love, and His way of life. And that's a one-on-one thing. It is, that prayer is answered in the 12th step, having had a spiritual awakening. You see, we are then empowered to carry this message to help other alcoholics. And we're given the opportunity to do so. And so many of us refuse it. We go right back into self. Somebody says, well, you got to balance your diet. Don't become an AA junkie and all this stuff, on and on and on. We say, oh yeah. Or the sponsors, God bless them, they're so benighted, they'll say, well, you've done your 90 and 90, now you don't have to go to so many meetings anymore. As if 90 and 90 had anything to do with it. It's got nothing to do with it. One of the most dastardly things that's floating around out there right now is that newcomers think if they do 90 meetings in 90 days, they're cured. That's a requirement. That's total nonsense. Balderdash. Without the steps, we don't have a program. We've got no program here without the steps. Don't drink and go to meetings is the biggest joke of all time. It would be an even bigger joke, except for the fact that it's pushing people in front of buses. They're dying every day because they believe that crap. How in the world can you go to somebody and tell them, on the one hand, you have a deadly, incurable disease, and if you don't stop drinking, you're going to die. And oh, by the way, the bad news is you can't stop drinking. Oh, but by the way, just don't drink. Now wait a minute. Which way is it? Either I can't stop drinking because I'm powerless, or you're telling me I've got to stop drinking. And then the next good question is, where's that in the book? Oh, it's not in the book. You mean nowhere in the book it says don't drink? No, nowhere. Why would you say to somebody who can't not drink, don't drink? That would be foolish, wouldn't it? The big book's never foolish. It's we who are foolish. The answer in the big book is what? To have a spiritual awakening. It's a spiritual answer. Find God and surrender to God. Get God between you and the booze. That's the only solution we have, and that's what happens when we work the 12 steps. Now, the 12 traditions bolster this in many different ways. For example, in the second tradition, the whole idea there is the group conscience. Well, group conscience these days has come to mean something like a half-assed democracy, where you have a power elite dictating the terms and conditions of the group, a very few people showing up at so-called business meetings, afraid to say anything because the powers that be will stomp them down, and therefore we take a vote, and it's supposed to be a group conscience. That's also total nonsense. It is a loving God as he may express himself through our group conscience. That's the only tradition we have. Now, what does that really mean? It really means that each of us must have examined his or her own conscience to see what the answer is that we believe God has decided we ought to give, and therefore we will come together and each of us individually vote in his or her own conscience. After having done whatever is necessary for us to be convinced that this is the way God wants it for our group and for us individually. Otherwise, it doesn't work at all. Many people have mistaken the idea that somehow or another the only time a group conscience can be taken is when there's a so-called business meeting. Well, first of all, A groups have no business being in business in the first place. We're not a business. If the IRS ever figured out we were a business, can you imagine the tax bill we'd have to pay? We ought to be staying as poor as we can possibly stay. Because if we go around with these massive so-called reserves, what do you call them, prudent reserves. You know what a prudent reserve is? It's an expression of pure fear. If you stop and think about it, it's utterly irrational. What you're really saying is the group stops meeting for a couple of months, nobody's there, and nobody passes the hat, and nobody puts any money in the basket, and therefore we need to have the money to pay for a group that no longer exists? How crazy is that? If we're still in existence, the basket goes around at every meeting and we pay our bills from the basket. Sure, they need a prudent reserve in New York because they're running a business up there. That's a wholly different matter. We don't. And so all of this gets twisted around to a point where power is granted to people who ought not to have any power whatsoever. They become twisted servants instead of trusted servants. And pretty soon what you have is a power elite that's dictating the affairs of the group. Now, the ultimate conclusion of that is that the group dies. It just dies. It goes away. Dries up and blows away. Alcoholism is a self-cleaning oven. And every time we break the traditions, we break the spiritual principles which are meant for the good of our group and the good of us individually. And when that begins to happen, it's just like we as individuals. If I go against the principles that I know I must live my life by, I'm bound to drink again. I will lose my spiritual edge. A group which does not abide by the traditions loses its spiritual edge, and eventually it blows up and goes away. I watched that happen 3 times in 2 years in North Miami. The Arch Creek group down there used to have 120 people out. They filled up a big church rec room. They had prominent circuit people coming to speak. They were a lively and wonderful group, and yet there was an in-group that got hold of them. They stopped sending money to New York and to inter-group. They started squabbling among themselves. Pretty soon they started losing members. They're gone. They're gone. They ceased to exist. The Biscayne room, same way. the upper room, North Miami Group, has been there for 30 years. They came so close to being out totally dissolved. And it was only by supreme effort by a few of their members that they still exist. And yet their meetings are down by 75% from what they used to be. They're not filling the need anymore. And they're filling the needs of the power elite who decide who is to be there and who is to speak, what the subject should be, and how you're to comport yourself. Even this stuff like that red sign back there, it says no profanity. Well, well, you see, there's a problem with that.
No expletives
permitted. There's a problem with that. We rent this facility for this hour and a half. We pay good money for the privilege of being here. And it's not appropriate for anyone to tell us how we comport ourselves so long as we don't tear the place up. This is a private club. We rent the facility. And that sign is about as useless as tits on a boar hog anyway. You know, if you'll excuse the tit expression. Now, Kevin doesn't use profane language anymore. No, that's right, I heard that. Because he's scared to death of these people, they might do something to him. Anyway, when we look at this second tradition, guys, we got to look at it from the standpoint of that AA is not a democracy in the sense that other clubs are. In fact, AA is in no way like any other organization on earth. There's absolutely no other organization that could possibly exist without any rules, regulations, or bylaws. Now, of course, we've got groups that have their bylaws. They've got them posted on the wall. There's 16 pages of bylaws. And if you read them carefully, you'll find that every one of them is based on some kind of fear. Fear that group conscience won't deliver the results that the people who wrote the bylaws think we ought to have. Okay, here's the way it's stated. Are there any conditions? The newcomer asks. This is third tradition now. No, not a one. When skeptically he comes back saying, but certainly there must be things that I have to do and believe, we quickly answer, in Alcoholics Anonymous there are no musts. Now you see what's happened is that the people who don't like the big book and don't like categorical imperatives, don't like the idea that anybody is telling them anything they have to do, they quote that as if that were true of the 12-step program. It's not at all. This is simply talking about the fact that under the traditions, every tradition is stated as we ought to or we should. Not one tradition says we have to. Not one tradition says we must. Because in every instance, the traditions are based on group conscience, not upon a set of rules enforced by AA police. And of course, the AA police, that would be the fondest dream of some of our power drivers. He says, how much is this going to cost me? There's nothing at all. There are no fees or dues. Our friend is disarmed of his suspicion and rebellion. His eyes begin to open to a new world of friendship and understanding. Bankrupt idealist that he has been, his ideal is no longer a dream. After years of lonely search, it now stands revealed. The reality of Alcoholics Anonymous bursts upon him. For Alcoholics Anonymous is saying, we have something priceless to give, if only you will receive. That's all. But to our new friend, it is everything. Without more ado, he becomes one of us. Well, now, if we look at the traditions, we find that across the board, they all are in the same tenor, that we're not here to dictate anything to anybody. Now, the big book, on the other hand, when it lays forth the rules for working the steps, let's say writes down and presents to us the instructions for working the steps, this is a history, guys. It is reciting what they did, the ones who wrote the book. They're not saying you got to do this, they're saying this is what we did. And we found out that for us, these are things we had to do. And we truly believe if you do what we did, you too will recover from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. The big book was written from this standpoint, to show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered, is the main purpose of this volume. And that's what they did. When you read the 12 steps, don't be fooled by people who say this is a we program. It's not a we program. The word we there is used to indicate what they did, each of them individually. It doesn't say they took their fourth and fifth steps together. It doesn't say that before they prayed, they all got together and prayed. What it's saying is that we, each of us, work these steps this way. There's some idea that only by hanging together as a conglomerate we that we're going to be able to recover. That's not the idea. The idea here is that we're together because we want to be. And anybody is free to go or come at any time. And it does not say that we pick one group and we stick with them, because many people aren't able to do that. And there's nothing. Clarence Snyder used to say, unity in AA is chaos. And if you're in a meeting, you don't like what they're doing, you find somebody else doesn't like what they're doing, you get yourself a coffee pot, a big book, start your own meeting. So that's the way AA grows. But if we are together in the sense of being together through the traditions, then we will never die. AA, as Bill was fond of saying, will continue just so long as the good Lord wants us and needs us. And this could be, to the extent possible with human beings, could be from now on. Now, when we think about tradition three, we're thinking about something, and we've got to keep in mind that tradition three is a total departure from any other kind of society. Because tradition three literally says to you and to me, you are a member when you say you are. There is nothing in the traditions, nothing in the big book that requires us to announce ourselves as an alcoholic. As a matter of fact, Bill often would say, and I agree with him totally, that one of the big problems is this business of anonymity is so closely held that we can be in a group with people for years and never know who they are. If they get in trouble, you can't even look them up in the phone book. You don't know their last name. This business of anonymity had never intended to include us within our groups. Now, of course, we honor the desire of anybody who wishes to remain anonymous, that's fine. And we certainly honor the desire of anybody to full confidentiality in anything that they may happen to reveal to us or to reveal in a group. There's some people that don't care. You can spread their story all over town and it makes them happy. Some people don't care if you announce to the world that they're members and they're full-blown alcoholics. Most people don't particularly want that to happen, so we honor that. But not out of fear. Please keep in mind that traditions are not based on fear. Not. And when you hear some of the stuff that goes on at the end of a meeting about what you hear here, leave it here, I can't remember all that stuff. But anyway, that's got nothing to do with the 12th tradition. 12th tradition has to do with the fact that we don't use our last names in public. The 12th tradition has to do with the fact that we sacrifice our desire and our apparent need for acclaim and notoriety and success, And being noticed as somebody special, we sacrifice all that by not announcing our last names. We stay anonymous because the principle there is a principle of self-sacrifice and of humility. And only based on that are we able to survive, because if each of us was out there trumpeting ourselves as being AA heroes and heroines, this thing would collapse in a hurry. And so as it turns out, the only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. Much has been written and said about this. There's a whole lot of flack going on now about who can be a member. Bill wrote an article about this in later years. He wrote two or three articles about it, and there's some confusion about it. If you are a member of NA and you never took a drink in your life and you have no legitimate reason to say you have a desire to stop drinking, still. This is the irony of it. You are a member of AA. If you balance, it would be true that they are an alcoholic as well as an addict. Can you imagine? It boggles the mind. Now here's the other side of that coin. Suppose somebody comes in here and they're lying their butts off. They just want to be a member here, and they like being in AA, or there's somebody in AA they like, and they're putting a make on. Whatever reason they may happen to be here, they figure there's more people with money who might do them some good. They just want to be here. But they're lying. Do we have to be afraid of that? No. You look up, you blink, they'll be gone. You see, even if they've got themselves fooled about it, that won't help either. Because without honesty, we don't survive in here. So if you find somebody who's violating the principles, who's masquerading as an alcoholic, and in fact is not, don't worry about it. Because the alternative is that we have to come up with some kind of a catechism, a religious test, like the Oxford group used to do. If you want to be a member of the Oxford group, they'd form a circle like this, and then they'd sit you in the middle on a hard chair, and they'd all throw questions at you. And at one time, the New York take any bum off the street. There were rules and regulations which, among the various groups, which were so stringent that if all of them were enforced at one time, no single member of the original 100 could ever have been a member of AA. That's just how, and you see all of these rules and regulations, at the bottom of them, they're fear-driven. They don't have any legitimate purpose. Because alcoholism solves its own problems. The person who does not work the steps doesn't stay sober. The person who doesn't abide by the traditions doesn't stay sober. The person who cannot, will or will not be honest with themselves and with others doesn't stay sober. You can quit worrying about it. And the group that constantly breaks the traditions and makes a mess out of everything and makes other groups uneasy and unhappy with them, don't worry about it. That group won't last. They'll be gone. Alcoholism is a self-cleaning oven, and we can count on it. All we have to do is take care of our own damn business and make sure that we stay spiritually fit and that we carry this message to others and help them achieve spiritual fitness. When we do that, then our lives become great and we're fulfilling God's purpose for us. I'm sure it wasn't His purpose for us to be the grand gurus and grand organizers of a great fellowship. Bill Wilson found out when he tried to do that it almost killed him. He got so sick he finally had to give up any pretext of being a big leader, because his dependency on the fellowship almost killed him. Except in matters affecting other groups or AA as a whole. This is another complete departure from the usual way of running an organization. Obviously, most of the time, in fact, in every group, if you were joining the Lions or the Rotarians or the Masons or even the Boy Scouts, you're going to find that there is an established protocol, and every group is supposed to live up to that. As a matter of fact, if a group fails to do that, they can be kicked out, disfranchised, not an AA. The way it comes down is that an AA group is free to conduct its meetings in any way it sees fit. An AA group could, if it wanted to, could have a Pentecostal preacher on one night and a Las Vegas gambling night the next night, a bingo game the next night. As long as they weren't doing anything to harm other groups, they'd be free to do that. Of course, the other side of that coin is that should they, in fact, go that far away from the purpose of an AA group, that they won't last. They will go away. The one stricture here is that if what they propose to do would be or could be harmful to AA as a whole or to neighboring groups, the very least that they should do is to get permission. Now, you almost never see that happen, but that's ideally, that's the way it ought to work. I remember years and years ago, a neighboring group to my home group was proposing to do something which they thought might interfere with my home group, and they actually came and told us about it and asked for our okay to go ahead with it. And most people were amazed by that because they didn't realize that that's what the tradition requires. Pardon? Yeah. Well, if you look at the tradition in the sense of even in a short form, it makes it clear that if it would be harmful to another group, we ought to have their permission at least before we do it.
Could you give me one example? You've been around for a long time. Give us an example.
Well, for example. groups that are close neighbors and tend to draw from the same population, if they're scheduling events or meetings which will could interfere with the activity of the group, they'll often, or ideally, they should come and discuss it and try to work out compromises of some kind so that they don't interfere with each other. Here's the way it reads: therefore, we AAs have universally adopted the principle of consultation. This means that if a single AA group wishes to take any action which might affect surrounding groups, it consults them. Or it confers with the intergroup committee for the area, if there be one. Likewise, if a group or regional committee wishes to take any action that might affect AA as a whole, it consults the trustees of the Alcoholic Foundation, who are in effect our overall general service committee. For instance, no group or intergroup should feel free to initiate without consultation any publicity which might affect AA as a whole, nor could it assume to represent the whole of Alcoholics Anonymous by printing and distributing anything purporting to be AA standard literature. The same principle naturally applied to all similar situations. Though there's no formal compulsion to do so, all undertakings of this general character are customarily checked with our AA General Headquarters. This idea is clearly summarized in the last sentence of Tradition 4, which observes, on such issues, our common welfare is paramount.
Would you say that, if I might just say, I'm David Nuffield, let's say another group, you have two groups in an adjoining area, one wants to have a meeting at the same time as the other group. You think that would be that type of a conflict?
Yeah, quite often it is. And quite often they will consult with each other. Because especially, for example, two groups scheduling a step study at the same time, if they're aware of it, will quite often consult. Or even an outside group activity, such as a picnic or that sort of thing, that could interfere with what other groups are doing. It's as much a courtesy as anything else, but it is in the principle of consultation, compromise, and unity that we do that. There's no compulsion, of course, that we do it. Tradition 5, each group has but one primary purpose, to carry its message to the alcoholic who still suffers. Now, this particular tradition, again, has a lot of controversy surrounding it today because so much has happened which was not necessarily foreseen back in 1945 or 1950. Especially the growth of other 12-step groups. There are 50 or 60, maybe some people say as many as 100 different 12-step societies out there now. Everything from Nose Pickers Anonymous to Lint Pickers Anonymous. Of course, there's also any trouble you can think of Anonymous.
I have heard of Ass Scratchers Anonymous.
Oh yeah, that one too.
The ones you mentioned, I never heard of.
So, but you see, AA has established itself, and it is quite clear that in all areas of recovery, because of our vast experience, because the millions of people who have recovered using the 12 steps and the AA program, we have much to offer to anybody. And also the fact is that the 12 steps are for everybody. They work for everyone. And so we have people constantly coming to AA who may not have alcohol as their primary affliction. And there's been a lot of controversy, a lot of written about it, and it's often talked about. There are still people around, old timers like myself, who sit in a meeting and count the andas. There's a good friend of mine who's a lawyer. I call him a newcomer. He's got 6 months less than I have. And after every meeting, he'll comment, sometimes just sort of under his breath, "Oh, there were only 6 andas here today. That's good." He actually bothers to count the people who are alcoholics and drug addicts, and they announce themselves as such. He calls them andas. So that, and there, on the one hand, it's quite clear, in order for the message to be carried, it's quite clear, if you read chapter 7 carefully, that in order for us to begin to work with somebody who's brand new, who walks in the door, we need to find a way to get them to identify with us. We need to establish our bona fides. We need to establish our credibility, that we know what we're talking about. And never having experienced, if I am an alcoholic who has never experienced any problem with drugs, I don't have any drug history, I can describe in some detail what happened to me as a result of drinking, but this might not be enough to establish a rapport with somebody who is basically a drug addict. And so there is that problem, and it's not always a problem, but it very definitely could be, and that forms the basis of most people's concern that AA is not set up to work with the addict. The truth is that the 12 steps, because they work for everybody, are universal in their application. And for the person who is new and who is able to get that first step under their belt, whether it be for overeating or for codependency or for alcoholism or drug addiction or whatever it may be, that first step can be worked. The rest of the steps are going to work just fine. And that's the rub, is being able to work successfully from the beginning with somebody who has a history different than ours. I have no compunction whatsoever in working with drug addicts, but I freely admit right up front that I don't know. I have no firsthand knowledge of the effects of drugs. I've got plenty of secondhand knowledge, tons of it, but no firsthand knowledge. So it's very helpful if we're going to help somebody who comes from a different problem area that they have first worked that first step. Other than that, I don't think it serves any purpose for us to be trying to regulate who's going to be in our fellowship. And there's an awful lot of lip service given to the idea that if you're in an AA meeting, you're supposed to talk only about alcoholism. The fact is that most people pay absolutely no attention to that. And I'm not sure that it's such a great idea anyway. The big book itself is quite clear in the fact that there was plenty of drug stuff going on with these alcoholics who helped write the book. In fact, on page 24, it talks about this, talks about the use of sedatives and the use of morphine. And so they were no strangers to drugs. And the fact that somebody has drugs as well as alcohol in their story ought not to in any way disable them from being a member here if they say they are. See, here's the problem. It's kind of a paradox, because on the one hand, we're saying you're a member if you say you are, and on the other hand, we're saying that you can't be a member if you don't conform to this specific formula for membership. And you can't have it both ways.
Well, it does say a desire to stop drinking. That is a requirement.
Correct, and it may well be.
Let's say that is a requirement. A desire to stop drinking. The person doesn't, and you can do whatever you want, but that's what the tradition says.
Well, of course, but remember that we're talking about tradition. And another tradition, this tradition tells us that we have no right to question anybody whether they have. How do you go about gauging somebody's desire? You can't. And if you say to me, I have a desire to stop drinking, that's the end of it.
Yes.
The person who is not willing to say that, who says, I'm here auditing your meetings in order to write a paper for my master's degree, it's pretty obvious they don't. But they're not pretending to be a member. They're not saying I'm a member.
You see, the word requirement.
Correct. Show me anywhere in the traditions where that can be enforced.
Can't.
So from a practical standpoint, the moment that I express the desire, that's all that's necessary, right?
That's right.
And so as a requirement, if we take requirement in the sense of some kind of a law or regulation, it just isn't, because it's unenforceable.
Let me ask you your opinion on this, like respect your opinion. If a person comes to you, Most in our generation, I'm 55, have drugs and alcohol in our life. Some are just, I'm more of an alcoholic myself, but let's take a person who has never, hypothetically, they never drank, they were just a straight drug addict, and they come to a person, they say, look, I want to get clean, I'm not an alcoholic, but I respect there's greater spirituality in this program, or whatever they say, and they want to work with an alcoholic. And they said, but I don't have a desire to stop drinking because I don't drink, but I do want to get well. In your mind, that's all it will take, in your opinion.
Well, I'm going to help anybody who wants to work the 12 steps.
Okay.
Because I don't believe we have any ownership of those steps. I believe that they're for everybody, and anyone who is sufficiently motivated to actually go through the steps and is honest enough with themselves to do it and has enough courage to face themselves, I'm going to help them.
And you're honest with them and say, look, if it is your experience, I'm not that experienced in drugs, but I can give you what I have. This is my experience,
sure.
And I can help you with this.
As long as we're upfront about it, and then I want to know that they are convinced that they are addicted, that they are convinced that they can never safely use drugs again for the rest of their lives. With that, we can go right to the second step.
Okay. No further question, Your Honor.
Okay. Yes, Kevin.
Can you do me a favor, and in that book, read the section real quick, problems on an outhole?
Well, that's about three pages, man.
Well, there's a section where it says the one time pure Douglas. It clears up all the confusion there.
My understanding is that Bill Wilson's writing, he said if the person did not have any alcohol problems, if they had both problems, there was no problem with his mind. If it was just strictly a drug problem, I believe you'll find it in that writing.
Yeah.
I read the same thing you read. I thought his feeling was that another fellowship could give them more help. That was that was his thought. That's what I recall. But you find a lot of people find there is more sobriety and serenity and spirituality in AA.
Yeah, I don't remember. I remember the article, but I don't remember where it is.
Chapter 4, problems with an alcohol.
Well, I know what it's called, but I'm just not having any luck finding it. I think, wait a minute.
That was a brochure. It was a brochure. I'm pretty sure of that also. Years past. Yeah, it's
well, let's move on if you guys don't mind.
Thank you for sharing.
Okay, so we're talking here about tradition 5, and here's what Bill has to say. It says, because it's now become plain that only a recovered alcoholic can do much for a sick alcoholic, the tremendous responsibility has descended upon us all, an obligation so great that it amounts to a sacred trust. For our kind, those who suffer alcoholism, recovery is a matter of life or death. So the Society of Alcoholics Anonymous cannot, if it dare not, ever be diverted from its primary purpose. Temptation to do otherwise will come aplenty. Seeing fine works afoot in the field of alcohol, we will be surely sorely tempted to loan out the name and credit of Alcoholics Anonymous to them. Should our present success continue, people will commence to assert today as a brand new way of life, maybe a new religion, capable of saving the world. How attractive these projects and ideas can be, how flattering to imagine that we might be chosen to demonstrate the old mystic promise, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. Fantastic, you say, yet some of our well-wishers have come to say such things. Fortunately, most of us are convinced that these are perilous speculations, alluring ingredients of that new heady wine we're now being offered. Each bottle marks success. Of this subtle vintage, may we never drink too deeply. May we never forget that we live by the grace of God on borrowed time, that anonymity is better than the claim, that for us as a movement, poverty is better than wealth. May we reflect with ever deepening conviction that we shall never be at our best except when we hew only to the primary spiritual aim of AA, that of carrying its message to the alcoholic who still suffers alcoholism. And what I'm suggesting to you is that in the process of carrying the message to others, and that's the principal purpose stated in the big book all the way through, except in one place only, and that's in the 12th step, which was originally written to carry this message to others, especially alcoholics. And it was rewritten by the editorial board. But we look at other parts of the big book and it tells us that we are to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. And that we ask God to take away our defects of character that stand in the way of our usefulness to Him and to our fellows. And we ask Him to take away our difficulties so that victory over them may bear witness to those we would help of His power, His love, and His way of life. I don't think there's any doubt in the world that we are not to limit our activities of carrying the spiritual message to people who are acknowledged alcoholics. This is speaking of Alcoholics Anonymous itself, that Alcoholics Anonymous should never fall in the trap of thinking that it was the universal solution to the problems of the world. That's the problem. That's where we would stumble big time. Individually, we have an obligation to be helpful to all people because we carry a message which is a spiritual message which is of universal application to everybody. And so I think that we have to be careful to differentiate between our personal responsibility to God and the people about us, and the idea that Alcoholics Anonymous ought to stick to its business and not try to be the universal solution to the problems of the world. Does that make sense to everybody? And this goes back to the one salient fact that in order for us to help people, we need to first be able to help the newcomer. And the newcomer who has an affliction other than alcohol is going to be difficult for us to reach if we're an alcoholic, because our experience and our story of our past, how it used to be, is not necessarily going to give us any credibility in their eyes to help them overcome the walls of denial in which they are hiding. But when somebody comes who wants to work the steps and who has sufficient motivation to do so, I believe it is our duty to help them. And I've done that many times, and it's worked quite well most of the time. Any further comments about that? All right, let's take a look at Tradition 6 then. An A group ought never endorse, finance, or lend the A name to any related facility or outside enterprise, thus problems of money, property, and prestige divert us from our primary purpose. Again, it's the same idea that if we're going to stick to the business of carrying the message to other alcoholics as a society, if that's our primary purpose. And by the way, that tradition does not say sole purpose, it says primary purpose. And keep in mind too that there's a little vignette in the 12 and 12 which recites the fellow who came to the early groups stating that he had a problem other than alcohol. And they were going to turn him away until somebody mentioned that thought kept coming through his mind, what would the master do? This guy is telling us if we don't help him, he's going to die. Well, what are we supposed to do, turn him out? And apparently, from that little vignette, the answer was no, and this fellow was accepted and became a very valuable member of the fellowship. There's got to be a lesson in there somewhere. Now then, remember that the Washingtonians made this, turned out to be a fatal error of lending the name of their society, not only to the abolitionist movement and the prohibitionist movement, but they were preaching their message mainly from church pulpits. They were depending upon the churches, which were deeply involved in prohibition, as their main source of converts. they were being accorded the opportunity all over the place by affiliation, in one sense, with the churches to reach out to people, many of whom were already convinced that alcohol was the work of the devil. Now, there was one major difference between the Washingtonians and the Prohibitionists. In general, the Prohibitionists preached a sermon of not of abstinence, but limited use. Just don't get drunk. But the Washingtonians switched that, and they were requiring people to come forward and sign a pledge of abstinence, which was different from what the Prohibitionists, by and large, were doing. In any event, they were very successful for a number of years. But because of the way they conducted themselves, and because of the way they had prostituted the name to what amounted to political groups, some segment of society, rather than to all human beings, they just simply ran out of steam. And of course, some of the original members got drunk as well, no matter how loudly they proclaimed that they had reached permanent sobriety. That didn't speak too well for their program either. And of course, these original guys, the six who started it, were well known, and they had a lot of publicity. And it was when they fell on their swords, it was also well known. None of that was kept as any kind of a secret. And so we're not going to lend our name to anybody. We're not going to get into any outside enterprises. We're not going to deal with outside issues. Now, of course, we recognize that, for example, many groups make an issue out of smoking. It really is an outside issue. On the other hand, the group has the right under the fourth tradition to set its own standards, as long as it doesn't affect other groups. That autonomy permits it to do so, but the group's got to understand that when it opts to go for non-smoking and is and preaches the evils of smoking, it's really adopting an outside issue, which probably has no place in AA at all. The prohibition on smoking, simply as a matter of preference, or even as a matter of health.
It's a health hazard that's very, very well established. That's a little different category. That's harmful to individual members. That's a little different category, I would say.
Could be.
Yes, it could be.
Okay, next week, I guess we're not going to finish this week, so next week we will try to finish up with the traditions. I would invite you, if you're